This is an IDE that I'm trying to put together for tacit verbs. It's sort of loosely based on the jig system that I put together early for looking at nouns, and it actually uses parts of that. I'm calling this Jervis, sort of a riff on Jarvis from Iron Man, I guess, although the bigger part of it is Jervis is a prominent inlet near where I live. So Jervis it is. Just going to put in the J sentence. This sentence actually does levels of parentheses, and so the typical display that I've entered is a linear one. That's how you would normally put a sentence in. This is what the box display of J would look like, and the box display gives you a little more spatial representation of what you're looking at, sort of gives you a sense of the different levels and how the verb parts, components, work with each other. I'm using this, or planning to use this, with some SVG, and the SVG allows me to separate the areas by color and also allows some interactivity. So there's the colors. Right now, in the very top, you can see I've got an X and a Y space. I have neither an X argument or a Y argument, and so the display looks this way because the black areas, it's indeterminate about whether it would be a monadic or a dyadic verb. Monadic verbs are green, dyadic verbs are blue, the conjunctions are red, the adverbs are yellow, and gray is usually set for constants or nouns. So that's just a rough legend for what you're looking at right now in Jervis. So if I move ahead, I'm going to put in a Y argument and enter that, and now what I get is I actually see what parts the parts have filled in, and this is what a monadic verb would look like. Now if I add another argument, so now I put in an X argument, that's what it would be looking like if it was dyadic. So you see certain parts of this change and other parts don't, because some things are set just by the structure of the verb as to whether they'll be monadic or dyadic, and it makes no difference at all whether it is monadic or dyadic. Those parts will remain the same. Other parts will change depending on whether it's monadic or dyadic. Because this is a parentheses level counter, for lack of a better term, it doesn't really make sense to have it dyadic. So the next thing I'm going to do is we'll take a look at the Y variable going in, and this is where the display starts to come in. So you see here, that's telling you what you're looking at, and then below that's the Y variable, and that's in the jig format. We'll see a bit later that it actually allows the same kind of interactivity as jig does, so you could hover and get tooltips and things like that about information about it. Don't have it on this particular prototype in this part. You'll see it later on. So if I look at this, I'm clicking on the largest. This is normally what you would see, the result. If you entered this verb in with this argument, you would see this result come back at you. It tells you it's a monadic result. If I click again, it toggles to tell me what my input is. So result and input. That gets kind of neat when I get into the components of things, because I can start to take the verb apart and try and figure out what's going on. So I'll move over to this part, and this is a monadic verb, and that's the result I will get. If I click again, it's got the same input. Well, that's because this verb is called same. It's got an infinite rank, and its action is to take what it's given and send it right back. It returns its argument. And that's done for structural purposes. Now, if I want to learn more information, I can also put in a link to Nuvok. And my plan is to have this as become a web page, so you could, in that window, you move around, you can get all the information you wanted from Nuvok, which is a sort of community-based vocabulary to explain things. Very, very useful. If you haven't looked at it before, you should. It's on the J Wiki, and just type in Nuvok and go to take a look at it. But that's one option, and then a real simple thing, just what am I dealing with, some really basic stuff. So that's that particular part. I look at this, for instance. Now I'm in a dyadic result. So the dyadic result is this. If I click again, that's my input for the Y side, my Y argument. That's my X argument, because I've got an X argument coming from one side, Y argument coming from the other. Click again, I'm back to my dyadic result. I can even go inside this. So if I want to look at how this is put together, there's my adverb. So it's telling me that I've got an adverb, and it's a dyadic adverb. It's got an X and a Y, so it's acting dyadically. It's got a verb, you. In this case, you can see the color matches, so that's the plus. And the adverb, which is yellow A, is the slash or insert. Want to know more about that? Sorry, because it's dyadic. It's actually table. It's not insert. So I take my click on the actual icon. It tells me this. It's a table. Its rank is infinite. What the action is and the description. It makes a table using the items of X and the items of Y. If I click again, I get an option to go back to NuVoc. I can do the same thing with this equal. That's a dyadic. Click again. I'm NuVoc. And then this is kind of interesting here. When I go back out to this area, I get the monadic result. That's not right, because it's... No, it should be dyadic result. I'm going to have to clean that up. Click again. I get Y, and I get X, of course. So that first part, that should read my dyadic result, because that's actually a dyadic verb. And when I go back out to here, I think we looked at that before. Well, that's the there you go. There's a dyadic result. So that's it should look the same in both of them. Click again. I've got my Y input in this case, and my X output. Now, the other argument came in from this side. So let's take a look at this. So it tells me the monadic result coming from this is that, and it had this as an input. Well, how does that input get to that? Well, I can take a look at this and take a look at here. It's got a value. Now, this part I've actually, my prototype I've automated, so I can click on this, and then it gives me the tooltip. So for all the things you've seen, I'll have this kind of a tooltip in there, so you could go in and actually inspect it. And I'll click on, go back again. And the same thing on this side. Again, this is going to look familiar to those of you who use JIG. See, it tells me actually the UTF number. So the encoding was 40 in this case, 41 of the previous one. And if I want to find out more about it, that tells me it's a literal of shape 2. So that information is just available down here. If I go through to here for the conjunctions, this is a conjunction. I'll find out more about it by clicking on the icon. Its name, they call it constant verb. Whatever it sends in, it returns a constant verb, and it makes a constant verb M, which would be the bracket side, the parentheses side, for every cell of rank N. So the fact that it's infinite means whatever it's sent in, it's just going to send out one cell of that those parentheses. Then that gets fed back into here. This is the entire thing. It provides a monadic result. Again, I can click on this. This part I have activated, so you can sort of start to see what JIG would look like in this case. You could inspect. You could find out it's a Boolean. Its shape is 212. This is all information you can do by clicking and just getting around. And you can go on inspecting other parts. So that's a monadic result. And again, we're out to the final result. So it's an idea about how to provide information about a tacit. You will be able to go back in and change things like this. The plan is if you took something out, then you would be able to go back in, which it would automatically change what the representation is. You can click on different parts, figure out what they're doing, and hopefully that would be of use. I think that's about it for now. I'd love to hear people's comments on that one. Thanks a lot.